My name is Brad Zdenek, and I'm with the Center for Online Innovation and Learning here at Penn State. I'm going to be helping relay your questions to our presenters today. I have the honor of introducing them, and I'm going to be serving as your host for the next 90 minutes. Before we get started, though, there are a few pieces of housekeeping to take care of. It's really important to us that this is an engaging session, so we ask that if you have any questions whatsoever or comments, please type them into the chat box on the right-hand side of your screen. Steph Malise and I, who are in the hosts box over on the left-hand side of your screen, will be keeping an eye on those posts and we'll relay them to the presenters whenever they open the floor for dialogue. If you have a question that perhaps you just don't feel comfortable asking in a public forum, you can also private chat me. To do that, hover your mouse over my name, Brad Zdenek, in the left-hand column. You'll have the option to private chat. Type or click on private chat, type in your question, and then I'll relay to the presenters anonymously whenever we have a chance. Finally, if you're experiencing any technical issues whatsoever, feel free to ask for help right in the chat box. Jim Salvaggio, our technical guru, or I will help as best as we can. So, with that taken care of, we've already held our sessions on planning, design, development, and delivery phases of MOOCs. So today we're going to be wrapping things up with a focus on evaluation. Luckily, we're joined by two of my colleagues who are immersed in the subject here at Penn State University. Leading the discussion today is Bart Purcell, co-director of the Center for Online Innovation and Learning, also known as COIL, and a driving force behind Penn State's efforts to collect, manage, and share the data streaming out of our current MOOC efforts. Bart is joined today by Larry Reagan, also a co-director for COIL and a member of multiple MOOC-related leadership, planning, and research groups across Penn State University. Welcome to you both. So, with our introductions out of the way, I'll hand the reins off to Bart to get us started. Bart?
Great. Thank you very much, Brad. Welcome, everyone. We know it's a Friday afternoon, at least here in State College. It's very nice out. So whether we go a full 90 minutes or not, we'll see. But please, as Brad said, feel free to ask questions in the chat. And we have a couple placeholder slides where we'll kind of stop at certain points that are logical breakpoints and ask if you have any questions about some of the things that we're covering here. So the way we've kind of split this up is that I'm going to talk a lot about some of the internal data we're collecting from our MOOCs in terms of what's actually happening within the confines of the MOOC experience. So when students are logged into, in our case, Coursera, we're a Coursera partner, so the five MOOCs we'll be talking about have all been run through Coursera. So I'll be spending a lot of time talking about what happens within the Coursera platform, the data we get, some of the things we're doing with that data. And Larry will talk more about some of the things we're learning about MOOCs that kind of happen outside of that course experience. So what's happening at the institutional level, some of the things happening with our faculty, and so on. And as Brad said, this is the fifth and final MOOCs by Design presentation on evaluation. And I do have to put it out there as well that this evaluation and assessment is very much a work in progress. We do have some interesting bits of data, but like a lot of this research, it often leads to more questions than it does provide answers. So this is just, we think, kind of the starting point. We'll talk about some of the different kind of places we want to go. So with that, I want to turn it over to Larry to talk a little bit about Penn State's goals when we first started to engage in the MOOC discussion.
Thanks, Bart and Brad. Thank you for hosting today's program. And hello, everyone. I'd like to just talk a little bit about how Penn State went about deciding to get involved in the MOOC movement, if you will. And I think it's interesting to reflect back of actually how brief this conversation, or how I should say recently this conversation occurred. It was only about a year and a half ago that Penn State was starting to kick around the idea of MOOCs and understand a little bit more about what they were. And different than how some other institutions went about approaching their MOOC work, Penn State was pretty intentional. And we spent a period of about 6 months actually thinking about why we'd want to get involved in MOOCs, and in particular, what were we hoping to gain from that process. And these are the group of six or seven or so that we settled on, and some of these have been added since then. And I say that because one of the advantages, I guess, we had of being involved in the MOOCs was a small group of individuals called the MOOC Strategy Group here at Penn State that met on a monthly basis, reviewing our progress, talking about research, talking about next directions, and so forth. And one of the things that that group has allowed us to do is to have a dialogue about what we're learning. And we discovered about halfway through our MOOC delivery was that we began to learn things and refine some of our initial data points based on our experience. These might be called unanticipated outcomes. And we took that and we began to sort of embed that into our thinking. And I think we have a ways to go yet in that aspect, actually. I think there's still things that we're learning and digging into that will continue to inform. So the items you see on the screen are really the initial intention. And I won't go down item by item, but you can see some relate to our large online program called the World Campus. We talked about how MOOCs could be used as a recruiting tool for both undergraduate and graduate education, but also for students in the World Campus. So we were intentional about picking MOOCs that would line up with potential offerings we might have via the World Campus. That has proved to be quite helpful, actually. We also felt that as an institution who's been engaged in distance education since 1892 at Penn State, beginning with correspondent study, we had a responsibility, if you will, to step up and provide some leadership, provide some early thinking, and certainly to be engaged in the dialogue so we were conversant around a lot of the methodologies and concepts and such. Finally, and maybe most importantly, I guess, was that we were really keen on what we could learn from MOOCs in this experience, and in particular, how that information from the MOOC experience would help us improve the design and development and delivery of courses at all levels throughout Penn State. So some of you know that Penn State is a very large institution. We serve something on the order of 85,000 students per year across our campus system. We have courses where we deliver at times to 200 or 300 or even 400 students in a single section, in a single auditorium. That's almost a massive course. It's not online, but it's a massive resident type course. Were there things that we could be learning about designing and developing and delivering MOOCs that we might be able to take and embed into the instructional design to enhance those face-to-face experiences as well? This is one of the interest areas of COIL. How can we take a disruptive innovation like a MOOC and learn pedagogical and perhaps technological advances that we can take and improve back into our resident instruction as well as our online program via the World Campus? I suspect that if we went back and asked our MOOC strategy group to revisit these initial goals, we might refine them some. But I think for the most part, Bart, I don't know if you would agree with this, I think we sort of captured the essence of what Penn State was interested in looking at as we got started.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this was a phrase our old director of TLT, Cole Camplese, used to use. And I think he may have actually borrowed this from Duke, that part of this is kind of fostering this culture of curiosity. And I do think he picked that up from some folks at Duke when he spent some time down there. And I think that's a big part of what we're trying to learn here is how does this kind of culture of curiosity and diving into this going to inform some of these other things we do and all the different modalities we serve here?
Yeah, perfect.
So we're going to jump into a little bit of the data that we're working with here. And we'll start at kind of a high level, and then we'll start to drill down into some of these different data sources on slides here shortly. So the data collection in terms of kind of the internal data, the data that we have about our students, about kind of what takes place within the confines of a MOOC experience, this is one thing, the MOOC team data, that we're actually backtracking quite a bit to collect more information about this. So trying to understand what exactly did all the different team members do? How many support staff were a part of each MOOC? You know, some of our MOOCs were essentially delivered with about three people, including the instructor. Other MOOCs were delivered with about 40 people, with the instructor, along with an armada of graduate students and TAs and so on. So we're actually doing a lot of backtracking now and collecting data that we didn't collect out of the gate that is now helping inform some of the other quantitative data we're looking at out of these other sources. So in addition to going back to the teams and the instructors and the designers and the TAs and so on and getting some information from them about the experience, we have some survey information. We run a pre and a post course survey on our MOOCs, and that's predominantly standardized across all five. There are some unique questions we ask that are discipline specific in some of these surveys for a course. But in general, we have a bank of about 15 to 20 questions that are standardized across all our courses that we asked with our first five MOOCs. So we'll talk about that in a minute on what sort of items we were asking. And then the big one is the Coursera data. Being a Coursera partner, they give you a lot of different types of data. At first, we used to joke that we used to, you know, we swim in Coursera data, but it might be more apt to say we drown in Coursera data sometimes, because it's a great deal of information they give you, and they're getting better with their documentation and their support and things like that. But it took us a little while to really wrap our heads around all the different information we have and how we could do some interesting things with that Coursera information.
Bart, can I interrupt you before you move on there? That Coursera data, recently I attended the Coursera conference, the second Coursera conference, and we weren't the only institution who was sort of complaining about that. How do you find in that particular, that service provider Coursera responding to that issue? But are they working with us in terms of structuring the data a little more better access at all, or?
Not so much on that level of structuring the data kind of based on requests or ways we would like to receive it. They are really good though about answering the questions we have about the structure it is handed to us in.
Okay.
So sometimes, and we'll talk about this briefly, the Clickstream data is a great example. There was no code book for it, so there was no kind of definitive place to go to understand all the bits that are contained in that data. And they're very helpful and amicable to go back and forth via email and things like that to really even get us in touch with their engineers at one point, because the program management on their end couldn't answer the questions either. So they had to go down to the engineer level on the Coursera side to really find some answers for us.
I'm curious if is there a community that's developing around sort of dealing with that? I mean, so it's outside of Coursera, I don't know, CIC or Big Ten or anything like that?
Being in the Big Ten, we have a small Big Ten community that's informal, that bounces a lot
a
of
network.
Questions around. Yeah. They do have some forums behind the scenes that if you were a classified as a TA or an instructor or a university support person for your courses, you have access to a lot of Coursera support forums and documentation.
Okay.
And there's also a lot of people doing things on places like GitHub. So people are building, for instance, the Clickstream data is really big, really ugly, and we'll look at that shortly. People are building data parsers.
Oh,
and they're putting it up on these kind of open source forums. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to find communities in really interesting places we didn't expect to find.
Huh.
Looking at Coursera data and building tools to help parse things apart.
Interesting. Okay, thanks. So the other part of this was looking at external MOOC impact, let's call it. And so a small group of institutions got together and began looking at how MOOCs are impacting the institutional aspects. So there's a research initiative called MOOC Institutional Impact Research Study, or MIRS. We've got partnerships with University of Pennsylvania, Penn State, Pitt, actually. I see some Pitt folks on today. And Imperial College in the UK, and then the Sloan C organization. And our goal has been to sort of look at where MOOCs are bumping into the corners, if you will, within the institutions. And Bart's going to talk about a good one here in a couple minutes, and that is data management, data ownership. That's a bump that we went through because we hadn't seen anything quite like this before. We didn't know quite where it belonged and how we were going to manage it, but I think it's a perfect example of that impact issue. Do you need new policies? Are there policies already in existence that can be applied, and so forth? And so our MIRS project is looking at a variety of these impacts across administrative levels, faculty levels, support service levels, and of course the student levels. And we're making progress. It's a little slow at times, to be honest, to get people's attention again around it. But I think if we can continue this path, we'll get some very interesting information that institutions can use as a case study, if you will, on a disruptive impact of something like MOOCs as a methodology of pedagogy, and then perhaps how those were mitigated as institutions began to internalize that particular disruption. So that'll be kind of interesting to see.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to step through some specific data sources now, just to give folks an idea of kind of what we get, and then a little bit later we'll actually talk a little more about what we're doing with some of these data sources. So in terms of the internal data sources, we have demographic data. This is data that's provided by Coursera. If you've signed up for a Coursera account, you know that you really only need to provide a username and a password and an email address. They would like you to fill out things like where were you born, where are you currently living at, what country you're currently living in, things about language and so on. But we find that only about 20 to 30% of the students, at least that were enrolled in our MOOCs, actually took the time to fill that out. So we do only have about a third of the data of our folks in terms of demographics. The pre and the post-course survey, those are things we administer in a tool called Qualtrics, and that usually goes out the first day the course opens. We administer the pre-course survey, and then as soon as the grades are starting to be, the final grades are starting to go out, we administer the post-course survey. And we figured out some tricks that are probably publicized on some Coursera sites that you can go on Google, that you can figure out ways to link up a Coursera student ID number to a Qualtrics survey. So you can do interesting things like not only see what they filled out on the surveys, but also track that survey ID into the course database and see actually their performance in the course and what they did and how they interacted with the content. So that's another thing we're working on as well. The two big pieces of data that we work with, the course database. So Coursera essentially at the end of a course section will export the course database. This is a MySQL database, and just kind of send you the raw export files. So we've developed a process here where we then just import those into a MySQL server on our end, and then we open up accounts for researchers across the institution to come in and work with that data. The Clickstream data represents data of all sorts of interactions within the course, and we'll take a look at that here shortly. And Coursera as a platform now are starting to provide a lot of interesting tools for faculty while a course is going on that are kind of, I say it's akin to taking the temperature of the course. You can go in and start to do some on-the-fly chart building and analysis and things like that. So their dashboard is actually getting a little better, that you can start to go into the dashboard and start to build out some interesting activity graphs, export details about assignments, and so on. So it's getting a little easier to work with.
And that's coming from Coursera.
On their end.
In response to probably institutions saying, hey, this would really help me as when I'm delivering the MOOC if I knew this kind of information.
Yeah. Okay, yep. Cool. Mm-hmm.
So externally as well, we were looking at where can we go for information from both administrators and faculty members and such. And so what we've done is to look at probably right now primarily interviews and surveys. We may be able to tap into some records information, but I know the experience here at Penn State when we started was to talk to those five MOOC teams and say, okay, you're all going to be recording the amount of time that you spent on this. And people said, well, you know, maybe not. I do this in the evening. This is on my own time. So even amongst our group, it became difficult to get people to kind of agree to very specific metrics so that we could look back. I think in the end we'll be able to get close, but we're probably not going to be able to nail it down to the individual data point. Mm-hmm. Same thing probably with dollars. If you said in the end, okay, what did this cost you? Well, you know, are you including in-kind resources that my department added, or do you just want external dollars that came from our college and so forth? It's tough to get people on those metrics. And I'd say, Bart, I don't know if this is your experience, I think in the beginning, they were a little hesitant to want to track it too closely, because if someone did look at it and it cost, I don't know, heavens forbid, $125,000 or so, somebody might say, well, stop that. You can't do that again. That's too much money. And so I think there was this little bit of a head, at least that's what I felt.
Yeah, I felt the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and out of the five MOOCs we ran, there were different, I guess you would say there were some people and some teams that recorded things in pretty good detail,
yes,
and others that were on the other end of that spectrum that really we have very little idea of the amount of time and effort that went
into. And, you know, before we move off the screen, just to state, it is difficult to actually measure. So we take our one colleague who taught in the geospatial mapping MOOC. And when we asked him, you know, how much time did you spend on it? And he said, well, there's kind of a difference between how much time I needed to spend on it and how much time I actually did spend on it. He said, I loved what I was doing. I was passionate. I did it on the nights. I did it on the weekends. You don't want to know how many hours I actually put into it. But was all of that actually required? And he'd say, probably not. But so teasing those two things out is tricky. Another one of our colleagues in Earth and Mineral Sciences, Annie Taylor, would say, you also have to be careful about looking at the time and the investment and presuming that every subsequent time you're going to be teaching the MOOC, it's going to cost you the same. She'd say it's much akin to developing the first time you develop an online course. It's going to cost in resources, time and money different than the second and subsequent times. Mm-hmm. So I think that's an important piece of understanding the data, some of the data points we're collecting.
Yeah, absolutely. I see here a question from Duke, and two more slides. We'll hit that. We're going to hit demographics here again, and at that point, I'll jump back in and talk a little bit about the differences there between the Qualtrics and the Coursera demographics. There's also, and we touched on it a little bit, some of this hard-to-get data. Larry alluded to kind of costs and personnel time, but we're also finding that the instructors that are teaching these MOOCs are using things like Facebook, things like Google+, things like social network sites that are big in other countries, for example. Some people are using LinkedIn heavily. And anecdotally, those instructors are telling us that that is where the most active students are residing, are in these spaces. So those are spaces that we, you know, poke around in a little bit and have looked at, specifically Facebook. And we do see, you know, a small subset of incredibly active students there. And we've taken some cuts at trying to understand some of that data rather unsuccessfully right now. And part of it is we can't match that data back up to any other data sources. So someone on Facebook, we have a trouble matching who that person is on our survey and who that person is in the Coursera database. But we are starting to try and figure out how can we better leverage some of these external platforms, because some of our instructors call those people the first line of defense. So if they upload a new assignment, for instance, and there's a mistake in the assignment or something's wrong with a video, those are the people that caught it first and posted back to the Facebook group and said, hey, you know, assignment 7 that was just updated about an hour ago and went live has this issue. So we think there's value in better understanding some of these external platforms and how it interacts, how people are interacting there compared to the actual Coursera platform. We are doing a little bit of work on matriculation data. So we're trying to understand students that engage in our MOOCs. Do any of them engage in future PSU activities? So do any of these students come to Penn State to be a resident student or an online student at World Campus? So what happens to these students? And we're slowly making progress here. Coursera, after a little while, we were under the impression that emails were kind of off limits. And through several conversations with Coursera, they started to share the email registration addresses for people that are engaged in our MOOCs. And now we're able to do interesting things like compare those email addresses to our undergraduate and graduate application database. So trying to understand, are people applying for admissions at Penn State that are also showing up in our MOOCs and things like that. And we have found so far on the first cut, probably only about 20 or 30 students that fall into that category. So we're making some gains there. And we want to do the same thing with alumni data. So we want to try and run some of these email addresses against our alumni database to understand what sort of participation do we have from Penn State alums inside of our MOOC. And we're really interested in what Harvard, I believe, did, where they started to go out to their alumni that participated in the first running of a MOOC. And when the second running was about to happen, they went back and said to some of these alums, hey, would you like to be essentially a TA as part of this activity? And the alumni, from what we've read, have all loved this experience. It's a way for them to reengage, you know, with their university, to add value, to talk with instructors again. So we think that's a great idea, and we're kind of thinking that might be a route that we also want to try and go down to as well.
Bart, our friends from Duke are mentioning that about 3% of their MOOCs students were alumni. And I just sent a post back and said, you know, did that number surprise you? Was that lower than you thought? It's a little lower than I might have thought. Mm-hmm. Do you have any sense for Penn State? Or is that so hard yet to still dig in to figure out?
We have looked at essentially how many at psu.edu email addresses were in our courses.
And the that may not reflect an actual alumni.
Right, yeah, right. Yeah. So we have not been able to run the alumni data yet. Okay. And just as an example, that our creativity course that had, I think it had about 150,000 people that signed up, about 98,000 active people. That course, I think, had about 200 at psu.edu addresses in it. And that was our biggest one. It was the biggest course, so that made sense.
Now, back, just to connect the dot, earlier, as a matter of fact, you started off by saying here that about only 20 to 30% of the registrants actually completed data forms where they might have identified it, where they went to college. Mm-hmm. So that getting to that, you know, if that's such a small number giving you that information, that's got to be tough mm-hmm. to then try to connect back to, okay, were they Penn State alums or not?
Yeah, the nice thing about the email addresses is we do have that for the whole population because you have to have an email to sign up for your account.
Right.
So that is one of the things that we do actually get for everyone, which is nice. And now to jump back to the demographics question here, I saw Duke asked, do you find that the Coursera provided demographics information matches or is different from the data you collect in your Qualtrics surveys? So we only have duplicate information for one of our courses, and we haven't looked at that yet. Coursera, when we first started, I'm not sure if it was just they were behind in terms of how many people were asking for information from them, but they did not send us demographic information for our first course. For our second course, we said, we're just going to collect it. Mm-hmm. So we added that to our Coursera Qualtrics survey. So we collected some information, and then they started to send us some demographic information, so then we stopped. So we really only have that for one course, and we have not taking a look at that yet to try and understand if that information's similar or different. I get the impression, since you asked the question, that you're probably seeing some differences there. And I'm kind of curious if that's probably, are you looking at IP addresses maybe, and kind of comparing where IP addresses and geocoding the IP addresses compared to where people are maybe indicating where they're coming from, which is something we'd like to do, we just haven't done yet. So what we do get from Coursera are things like the age, the gender, the country of origin, as well as the country of residence of our students, proficiency in English, their employment status, and what profession they're in. And a couple of the interesting things we see here is almost every one of the courses we've run, the highest indicated profession or the second highest indicated profession has been education. Mm-hmm. So it seems like, and this is natural, right, a lot of educators are poking around in here trying to understand how these things work, how these operate. So we do see a lot of folks coming in from education into all of our courses, I think, just to try and learn a little bit more about how this works.
So if that's the case, Bart, it's kind of hard to know what their real intentions are. Mm-hmm. If I'm an educator and I want to look at this as and study it sort of as a disruptive technology or methodology, that's different than the fact that I'm really interested in art mm-hmm. or I'm really interested in geospatial mapping, you know. Mm-hmm. So it complicates a little bit extracting motive. Mm-hmm. Why are people taking these?
Yeah. We did run one study where we looked at we tried to use some of the demographic data as well as the Coursera database data to figure out what are the biggest predictors of completion. Mm-hmm. And in terms of demographics, one of the interesting ones were one of the biggest predictors were people that were born outside of the United States, mm-hmm. and were fluent in English but not native English speakers. And why that is, we were wondering, are these people that are sampling, you know, grad school places potentially?
Oh,
because usually the average age was in the mid to late 30s, so we thought maybe these were people sampling, you know, U.S. institutions for grad school. The other kind of hypothesis is that maybe a Coursera credential is much more meaningful in other places of the world than it is here. There's still debates on, you know, what do you really get out of mm-hmm. a certificate of completion? Mm-hmm. You know, is that going to get me a job or get me a promotion or things like that? I'm not so sure in this country what that gets you yet, but maybe in other countries that is a much more meaningful credential to have. Mm-hmm. So that seemed to be the people that were much more interested in completing.
You know, I'm just wondering on that that last slide there, is there, in order to, because now I'm understanding that we'd only have this kind of data if somebody filled out the form, and we now know that only about 20% of people fill out the form. So there's now, granted, 20% of 100,000 is still a lot of people, but we're missing a lot. Has anyone talked about strategies that would embed these kind of questions into the actual delivery of the course? Now, I know it would be harder to extract But you sort of sneak him in there a little bit somehow on those really maybe the two or three really important ones you might want to get at.
Yeah, no one has yet. We did have someone make a comment that was not well received about maybe before the course content opens, there's kind of a gatekeeper assignment, essentially a survey, right?
Yeah,
a gatekeeper assignment that you have to provide maybe for the answers to 5 or 10 questions. And then the course content, you know, opens up for you. And all of the instructors had a very negative reaction to that comment.
Didn't like that.
And I can certainly understand why.
Sure.
But yeah.
I like the strategy, though. It was sharp.
Yeah. The pre-course survey that we run, we'll get into some of the answers of how folks identified in the pre-course survey in a few minutes. We asked a lot about the motivation for taking the course, whether it was kind of motivated by profession, motivated by friends taking the course, things like that. We asked about the intended course behaviors. Did people anticipate they were going to finish the course and get a certificate? Did people intend to watch all the videos? What were they setting out to do? One of the more interesting questions we asked, and we'll get to the responses here in a few minutes, we asked about previous experience with content area, but more importantly, previous experience with online learning. And I was very shocked when we look at that data, what came back with some of our courses. So that was one of the more enlightening questions that I think we asked. The course database, this is that course thing that powers the Coursera platform, MySQL database, captures all sorts of information, video views, quizzes, forum interactions, peer assessments, and so on. It's a 41-table relational database, and I'd like to thank our friends at Michigan and in the Use Lab for providing this. They kind of sent us a, not necessarily an entity relationship diagram, but they kind of put this thing together for us and said, hey, you know, have at this. This is what we think the database looks like. Here's how all the keys are put together and what it looks like and so on. So it's not the easiest data to work with, and a lot of our researchers in the College of Education, they probably have the most skills to analyze the data and the best research questions to ask, but they're also usually not trained in things like structured query language, interacting with big data sets and relational databases. So we've had to kind of develop an interesting workflow to get clean data sets to researchers that really have the skills to do the analysis and make the most meaning out of the data. The post-course survey, we asked some things about the quality of the course, the positive aspects as well as the negative aspects of the course, and things about how much workload it was, whether the pacing was right, as well as the difficulty levels. And we'll look at a couple responses here shortly on some of these questions. And then last but not least, we're just now starting to make some sense of the clickstream data. This is every click that a student makes in the course, and primarily it's in the form of how are they navigating from page to page. So when they log in, where are they going first? How are they moving around between log in and log out? And also, and I think a little bit more interestingly, the video player interactions. So when are they pausing? When are they rewinding? When are they fast forwarding? And so on. So all those pieces of data are captured.
Bart, could you just go, you know, I'm going to ask more questions here. On that clickstream data, does Coursera time out at some point? If I log onto a screen and then I get up and go to lunch or whatever, how do we know how long they're there? Is there any?
I'm not sure. We haven't gotten into this data deep enough to figure out the timeout. If it performs anything like our course management system, I would imagine there is some timeout.
That's 90 minutes, I think.
90 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. And that's always been a hard feature to add in, because you know you really don't know if they're sitting and absorbing, if they're taking notes, what exactly they're doing.
Yeah.
Where the clickstream data is the more active clickstream data is going to give you a pretty good read that they are active. It's when that activity drops off that then you're trying to guess what the heck's going on there, and it's hard to tell.
Yeah. So this is what this looks like. This is from our maths course, and this is from kind of a coding perspective. It's called a JSON object. So in between these parentheses, there are all these different kind of nuggets of data here. And essentially, why this became very troublesome out of the gate, you know, I know enough to be dangerous with programming, but not enough to make much sense of this. And when this comes at you in a file that's 7.5 gigs with 5 million of these objects in it, it was the first time as an educational researcher I ever ran into computational problems. My computer would just freeze, and you know, it was very difficult just for my computer. And I have a decent Mac with some good CPUs in it, you know, but we're really kind of just now figuring out how to squish this into a database, how to parse this, how to make sense of it, and so on. So we're starting to finally learn more, and I'll talk a little bit about kind of our first experience with the Clickstream data and some of the interesting things that we're finding. So that's going to be the first point. I think we'll stop for questions, and we'll answer a few questions, and then we'll jump into a little bit of what we're actually finding in the data.
So give us opportunity, if you have questions, please go ahead and type them in the chat box, and we'll relay them to Bart and Larry. Well, one that came to my mind, Larry, and Bart, you can jump in on this, but Larry, one of the things you said sparked a question in my mind, which was one of the goals here at Penn State is to take some of what we learn through these MOOCs and roll them into some of our more traditional offerings, whether it be our more traditional online offerings or even, as you said, extremely large face-to-face offerings. Are there any mechanisms at play here at Penn State in order to help that movement of what we're learning from this data to our practice? Or is it simply opening this data up for researchers and then going through the typical academic publication process to get it back into practice?
Well, if we wait for that formal process to occur, it's going to be a long, bloody time until that happens. I mean, and that's not a bad thing. It's just the reality that we live in. I mean, for a formal, I think we're getting, we are beginning to internalize, if you will, some of that initial data that's coming back, Brad. We are anecdotally hearing from faculty. We're now through the MEERS project, going out to the PIs and saying, what did you learn? We're in tune with several other MOOC research kind of initiatives where what I would call, and this is what I heard at the Coursera conference, sort of nuanced details about serving large classes is just really interesting. So, for example, one of the things that they talked to, and I can't remember the school off the top of my head, but they were talking about how they discovered the power of the N, if you will, having so many hundred thousands of students, or even tens of thousands of students, and being able to identify the lead individuals, people who are doing really well for whatever reason, then being able to capitalize on those people through a vetting process to become more engaged in the instruction of the courses. Well, that's kind of an interesting idea. We do that in a sense by using TAs within our classes, both face-to-face and online. But now I think you start to think about, you know, are we really capturing that source? And as one of our speakers said yesterday, a guest of ours was talking about the idea of identifying lead individuals, and you can name them after your mascot if you wish. So ours might be lions or something, and who may be getting bored, you know, because they're already top performing students. It's hard to kind of keep them energized moving forward. But what if you were to identify those people and then find a mechanism that used them as a teaching resource for the other students? And this goes back to the idea of you know, peer-to-peer assessment, where you can vote students up for, oh, that person consistently gives a really good, strong answer. This person, not so much, you know. So I think it's really beginning to challenge some of the philosophies we've had in particular about online learning. It's challenged my beliefs that, you know, the cap of a good online learning course is 25. Well, heavens forbid, 25 is not very scalable. And now I'm thinking, well, maybe that was under a certain set of constraints. But if we change those constraints some, perhaps what we're learning about MOOCs can improve the instructional quality. Now, I don't want to say that we abandon oversight, right? Academic oversight and the role of the instructor is absolutely critical, especially when you're in a paid environment like a tuition-type course. But I think we are learning some strategies and seeing some really interesting nuanced effects that have potential really high impact for our classes. Are you seeing the same thing?
Yeah, a little bit. And I'll kind of take this in a little different direction that piggybacks on a question that Duke just asked here. And what types of research questions are you thinking about using Clickstream data for? There are a couple different things that come to mind. There are three primarily that we're kind of working through now. The first is what we call identification of pain points. So can you look at the data and see where people are rewinding off, or can you identify places that people are rewinding or seeking frequently? And then if you look at those videos, once you see the video, can you then figure out, is this a cultural issue? Is this a language issue? Is this a conceptually hard piece of content? Is it
clarity.
Not, is it not, yeah, is it unclear? Right. Is it not expressed very clear? So we actually set down off this path and then found out from Coursera that some of their timestamp data was inaccurate in the click transformation. So I, Duke, I don't know if you got into that as well, but they basically, we got all the way down to their engineers, and their engineers essentially said, you know, some of this timestamp data in the video handler doesn't get captured correctly. So in essence, what they told us is you can't figure out for certain whether they were going forwards or backwards. So at that point, we just kind of put that on timeout, but we do want to revisit this whole pain point idea, and can you come in and kind of dissect that? Another thing that we're looking at that I think is very interesting is that our MOOCs all approached video differently. So we had our epidemics course that had incredibly high production value videos with animations. It looked almost like UPS commercials, mm-hmm. where people are like writing on a whiteboard and things are animated. So they put in a lot of resources in terms of dollar and human power to make these really incredibly high production value mm-hmm. videos. Can we learn anything when we compare the video habits of people that were in that MOOC to the video habits of the folks that were in our MAPS or ART MOOCs that were much more, you know, webcam in person in front of a, you know, a backdrop, just kind of talking and explaining things, no high value production. And then we have a third variable because our creativity course folks actually had a theater coach. So someone that was versed in theater and was coaching them on the best way to deliver succinct, concise messages, you know, via video. So we have these three different approaches to instructional video, and can, through the click data, can we understand, you know, what the values are of each? And the big question we get from the administration, especially around that epidemics video, is, was it worth it? Right, because it was a good deal of resources invested, and we need to try and justify that, you know, that was worth it, and we did get value out of that high production stuff, or, you know, maybe not. Maybe we don't need to spend that much resources to get into that kind of stuff. And last but not least, this is the age-old question, right, of can you identify the ideal length of an instructional video? Mm-hmm. And we think that this kind of large kind of corpus of data, that especially if we start sharing data across institutions, you know, we probably could answer that very scientifically and say, you know, even by discipline, that we think this, you know, a 4-minute video in social sciences is the ideal video length. You know, so there are things I think we could do there.
Yeah. You know, I think on that video, you breaking it down into those three dimensions is kind of interesting. Let's say that the middle one has to do with this. I'll call it they're all instructional videos, but you know, the sequential reveal, building of solutions, the animations that make complex concepts into simpler to understand, that they become, I mean, they're all teaching tools in a sense, but it's a different type mm-hmm. of a teaching tool. The thing that just pops into my mind is as you said, the production time and such for that. Is that something yet that we're able to have? I mean, once we know better if that's actually the desired methodology, are those the kind of videos we ought to be concentrating on? And then what are the tools that allow us to do those things relatively easily? And instead of me now sitting in front of a video camera describing it once again, and you know, the people who are just processing it auditorily, is there a way that I can go in very quickly with a, you know, a screen capture type device, watch as I build out, say it's a formula, for example, in math, which, by the way, you wouldn't want me doing, but it'd be entertaining. You know, I think that could be that it's really informative. Mm-hmm. And again, comes back to my thought of those kind of devices being used and beneficial both in the online space and in the resident space. Mm-hmm. And I can watch them as many times as I yep. need to.
Mm-hmm. And that's another thing, too, that we want to hit on. So how many times are people consuming videos? Yeah. And one of the strange things we find, and this was in the course database, not clickstream data, then we'll move on here, is that we saw some users that were watching thousands of videos in a week. And this was in a course that had 30 videos total. So we didn't understand if somehow people were syndicating videos out of the Coursera platform. We're very confounded, I guess you might say. Because we find these really weird head scratchers in the data, where some people are accounting for thousands of views, which, And some people say, well, maybe they're sharing accounts, which I understand that, but why? It's a free, you know, it's a free account. Why is
but thousands?
Yeah,
that's
yeah. There's some really kind of interesting things. So moving forward, what we want to do is take a look specifically at our first MOOC, Intro to Art Concepts and Techniques, and kind of use that as the platform of how some people answered the survey, some of the ways we're cutting up some of our data, because this is the course, our first course, the one that we've spent the most time with up to this point. So this is just some screenshots of what you get from Coursera. They give you what I would call rolled up demographic data, as well as very detailed level CSV file demographic data for each student. So the nice thing here I think is very interesting is that they'll do comparisons for your course, and that's kind of the left-hand column, against the Coursera averages. So Coursera as a whole versus your specific course here. So as you can see right away, this art course was almost reversed in terms of gender, right? It was female dominant, where we see in Coursera on average, it's a much more male dominant course experience. So there's some interesting things that you can get as a glance from some of these kind of rolled up demographic information that they send you. There's a lot of information here about English speaking, right? How fluent people are in English, both in terms of writing and reading. And there's also some information about highest degree acquired. And I think a lot of people realize this now is even though MOOCs were sometimes sold as, you know, free access to education for all, for the underprivileged and so on, we do see that usually about 70% or more of our students have a bachelor's degree or higher. But still, it's one of those weird things where you talk about percentages that seems like, you know, 70%, that's the majority, but that 30% is still a really big number. So there's still a lot of people coming in that represent that 30% there. So we're going to pivot now from a little bit of the demographic information to some of the things that we're doing that come out of the course database. So some of the things that we like to do is to come in and generate kind of temporal week-by-week snapshots of how different groups in the MOOC are interacting with the course. So what we're looking at here is forum activity. So the x-axis represents weeks. So this was about a six-week course. And the different lines here represent completion status. So the blue line are people that did not complete the course. The red line were people that completed the course at the normal level. And what that meant in this course is that they mastered the content that was tested via quizzes. Mm-hmm. So they mastered the five quizzes. And then the distinction level were students that mastered the quizzes and created two unique pieces of art and peer assessed other artwork as well. So that was the distinction level. And you see right away that at about week three, things really start to taper off. You get a flood of activity really early on, and then it kind of tapers off here about halfway through the course. Now, one of the interesting things here that we looked at this course compared to our MAPS course, and our MAPS course graph looks very different. It looks very much more active. And as a researcher, we kind of thought, huh, well, that's interesting. What's so special about MAPS that's going on that there's so much more activity here? Turns out we went back to the MAPS team and they required forum participation for their completion requirement. So that was one of the things that prompted us now to go back and essentially create a course design matrix for all five of our MOOCs. So when we see strange things in the data, that's the first thing we consult and we try and figure out, is there a reason by design that the data looks this way? Because some courses only use quizzes and no peer assessments, some use peer assessments and no quizzes, some people required forum interaction. So there were all these different unique design decisions that came into play here that would just give us a much deeper understanding of the data when we see kind of these strange irregularities show up over courses. And that was something we should have done on the outset, but we kind of backtracked into it and are now continually building out this design matrix of all the key design decisions for all these different MOOCs. So this is one of the more interesting graphs that I like to look at, and we're trying to figure out how can we build some research studies around this phenomenon here. Right now, we're looking at video views over weeks. So as you see, you know, the folks in blue who were, excuse me, non-completers started out in week one watching just over 180,000 videos. What I really find interesting here is way out in week seven and even after the course ended, non-completers are still watching about 40,000 videos a week. And if you read, you know, a lot of the articles that are written about MOOCs, people want to make a big deal out of completion percentage. And I think these are kind of that category of people that get lost in the discussion. So I would argue that these folks that are in here, you know, and spending a lot of time interacting with this content are probably having a very valuable, positive learning experience, but we don't really see that reflected anywhere. So one of the things we're trying to do is put a magnifying glass on these people to try and understand how are they interacting with the course, can we match this back to demographics in any way that will give us any clues, and how can we just kind of further explore this group. And this is another graph that kind of represents the same phenomenon here, is that this is kind of duration, what we call activity duration. So what we do is we essentially look at the first day the student came into the course and the last day the student came into the course and just count the days in between those dates. And we kind of call that the student's activity duration. So what you'll see here is, you know, the people that completed the course were active about 41 to 50 days. But you also see in that blue line, there were a heck of a lot of non-completers that were also active 41 to 50 days. And again, we want to figure out who are these people. Based on our previous study in terms of predictors of success, one of the guesses we have is maybe these are native English speakers from the United States that just really don't care about a certificate, but they do want to learn something and gain new information. So that might be one of the things that we're seeing here, but we really don't know. This is an area we really want to try and explore a little bit more. And this is some of the things that we're generating out of the video viewing habits. I see we have a question from Laura that we'll come back to here in a couple seconds at the next break slide. At the video viewing habits here, we pulled this out of the Clickstream data, and essentially we looked at every video and calculated what percentage of students that started the video watched it through to the end. So, and then after we did that for each video, we kind of rolled that up to a weekly percent completion for video viewing habits. So for instance here in week one, only about 22% of the students that started a video watched it through to the end. And you can kind of, this makes sense, right? Because early in the course, you have a lot of people that are just dabbling. They're not sure if they're going to stick around. They might be sampling some content. So you see by about week three, it starts to jump up quite a bit. So the highest we saw was at the last week here, 57% of the students that started videos finished them. And one of the interesting things here we found as well, and somewhat comical, the video that had the most people that completed it at 80% was a 9-second video. So there were 20% of the people that 9 seconds was just too long to commit to. So it's there's some really head scratchers, you know, when you start to pick apart some of this data. And those are just lesson introduction videos, right? The instructor kind of previews the lesson for the week and so on.
Bart, can I ask you though, on the week seven, so we're up to 57%, which is good. But by week seven, how many people were left? So if you map those two things out, how does that data wash out? Because I would suspect now that you're down significantly in number of participants.
Yep.
But of those people who stay, you've got a larger number now watching it all the way through.
Yeah, and those are the serious folks. They want to, if they're there at the end, they probably want a certificate potentially, right? At least I would imagine, you know, a good amount of would want a certificate and so on. So this is kind of our first foray into the Clickstream data. And does the length of the video matter, Barbara asked, and we do find...
9 seconds.
Yeah, 9 seconds is a little too long for a lot of people. We don't have any detailed findings on that, but as you would suspect, you know, as you get into 7, 8, 10 minutes plus, it starts to just go down a little bit. And we are working to try and figure out for each course what seems to be that ideal threshold. So how long can you run a video until you start to see a significant decrease in people dropping out? So that is one of the next steps that we're trying to take a look at. So let's jump back up here to Laura's question. How did you match up non-normal distinction with the activity data provided by Coursera? So that's actually also in that database. So in that big relational database, one of the tables has student grades. And in addition to having a percentage grade, a student has what's called an achievement level. And the achievement level are those three categories. It's non-normal or distinction. And then what you can do with that database, excuse me, using SQL, that's typically what we use to interact with the data, you can start to put together data sets that match up students' achievement level with all their interaction habits. So how many students, how many posts are students making per week? Per completion level, how many video views are people watching or people having per week, per achievement level. You can start to kind of start to wrangle in different data in different ways using SQL. And then once we get that done, we usually pull that into something like SPSS or your data analysis tool of choice to start kind of slicing that up in different ways.
I'm curious, how did you define completion in watching those videos? Because I'm thinking, I'm reflecting back on my own video watching practices, and I know there may be a 9-minute video, but if the presenter stops speaking at 8 minutes and 39 seconds, and then there's 20 seconds of the video fading out,
Wind
I stop it or I close it.
Yeah.
Did I just get marked as a non-completer?
In our data, you probably would have. And that's a good point. We probably should go back and see if that's a phenomenon in the videos, to see if the videos are actually, you know, for example, the instructor stops talking, it fades to black right over 10 seconds and then ends versus the instructor's talking right up to the end and then it just drops.
So maybe changing the one variable of saying what is the content-rich part of the video maybe goes to 850 rather than 9 minutes, then measure against the 850 rather than the 9 minutes.
And I bet you we would see the numbers increase a little bit, I'm sure, if we could
that
account
would be
for
interesting.
That there.
So one of the drawbacks of being the last person to present over the week is that some of the questions get kicked down the road to you. So one question that we've had come up twice so far this week, and both sets of presenters kicked the can to you, was identifying any sort of correlation between the amount of video use in a course and completion, particularly completion with distinction, finishing the course to the highest level. Have you noticed in going through that data, is there any sort of correlation you're seeing between those video-heavy courses and completion compared to the text-heavy courses and completion?
We have not yet, and that is something we're looking at, and where that gets even more complicated, and this goes back to that design matrix that we've kind of backed into now. We've asked specifically how much relation on video is like how much do you intend to, the course to be relying on video in this design matrix. And we ironically have one course that by the designer's opinion is 10% relying on video, which is incredibly low, right? And then we have another that's 100 and we have everything in between. So it makes it, it's like a third variable that makes that a harder question to answer. But that is something we're trying to figure out, but we have yet to pull that data together.
You know, here's one data point that I think we have to be careful about how we then interpret into and its use into online and resident-based instruction. Are MOOCs a unique enough framework because of who they're reaching out to and their pay model and such? So let's say it comes back that we learned that, you know, you get the highest percentage of completion when 90 or higher percent of the course is done video. You want to be careful with extrapolating that back into the classroom or the online, because the very structure and design of the MOOC is fundamentally different than online course and things. So just kind of a thought that's come popping up into my mind.
Yeah, and I see the question from Dave, do the production values of the video make a difference to view the completion? That's what we're trying to figure out right now. We have that data for the art course in terms of how many people that started videos completed the videos, and we want to run that same data for the other courses because then we can make some of those comparisons to see if the quality or the approach to video might have an impact in terms of people watching them the whole way through. What we do know is that our completion percentages, and I usually intentionally leave this out and don't talk about completion percentages because I don't think it's a very valuable thing to talk about in regards to MOOCs. Ours are always around 5 to 10%, regardless of the course that we're in. So I mean, I think that gives us hints on kind of maybe regardless of the intention or the reliance on video, maybe it doesn't matter a whole lot. That's one argument you could make because the completion percentages don't seem to differ much across all these courses, but you know, that's just a guess looking at how things come out. But
that tracks with what Coursera is reporting as well, about 5% completion. So we're right in that zone.
Yeah, and don't get me started on
Okay.
We'll touch on that here shortly. Okay. Yeah. So I want to take a quick run through some of the survey comparisons. So what we've done now is we've taken all of our MOOC data and squeezed it into a single survey, a single data set that we can do some comparisons across courses. So we're comparing how students in our pre-course survey answered across all five of our MOOCs. And this is probably the most interesting data I think we've found so far, is we asked people about previous online learning experience. So the furthest bundle of bars on the left is, I have taken other MOOCs. And that's 35% or lower for all of these MOOCs. But the thing I found fascinating is that the art course, there is actually a very little bar there, you just can't see it. But the art course had virtually no one that had taken other MOOCs before. Part of that was that our art MOOC was the first MOOC, so I think that was also a timing thing. But I was still relatively shocked that that no one in that cohort, yeah, essentially, there was a small number of people, had taken a MOOC before. And then if you swing all the way out to the bundle on the right, none of the above. So these are students that have never had online learning experiences, whether MOOCs for credit, not for credit. They've never taken an online course. And you can see that's anywhere from about 25% all the way up to 45%. Maybe this was just my own preconceived notions, but I anticipated most people that would engage in MOOCs would have some form of online learning experience. That was just my own naive assumptions, I guess. So I thought this was very interesting and very telling in terms of how people are interacting with online learning before they come into our MOOCs.
Do you think that suggests, Bart, that you've tapped, that MOOC tapped into a new population that previously wasn't finding interest or what they needed in either online for credit or non-credit? And
or they just weren't willing to pay for it, right? Maybe they knew there were some online learning things out there that fit their niche, but it was
or
just prohibitive.
The other one I might add is didn't have the ability to pay for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
And
absolutely.
This now met a need.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So there are some interesting things around this question. I found the answers to this question so very interesting. And then we asked things about why are they taking the course. I'm taking the course out of general interest, curiosity, or enjoyment. Most people did agree. So things seem to fall on the right side of the graph here, which is the agree and strongly agree. But you do see some in the middle there. The green bar represents art, and the purple bar represents math, so that was a little more of an even distribution. But for epidemics, creativity, and energy, the majority either agreed or strongly agreed that they were taking the course out of general interest, curiosity, and enjoyment, not so much because it maps to their profession or what they're doing.
Speak, though, because I know you've said this before, can you speak to the purple one? Why is the potential that strongly agree is so low for MAPS? We have an idea there, I think.
Well, one of the ideas is I think that's a very disciplinary specific thing, and maybe those folks were in their cartographers, geographers, and so on. So they were in here to actually get some value that they could apply.
It's kind of a reverse, though. Mm-hmm. It sounds like, geez, nobody was generally interested, curious, or enjoyment. Why were you in the MOOC?
Yeah.
But to your point, if they were already professionals, mm-hmm. and Anthony, I think, reported that, they may answer that to say, no, I wasn't in here out of curiosity.
Yeah.
I was in here because I needed it.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Or I was interested, not generally, but specifically because it's my field of study.
Yeah. And looking back at this, and we're reevaluating this summer, some questions we asked I do not think could be framed better, mm-hmm. and I think this is one of them.
Good
I think
point.
We could ask this in a more clear way, mm-hmm. and get better, more meaningful responses. But again, as these MOOCs hit so fast, it was a rush, rush to get things in place. So some of the items I think we can improve upon. So the next two slides I think are interesting and something I think we're trying to remedy a little bit. This asks our students, I'm interested in connecting with other students interested in this topic. And as you can see, most of this is swayed on the left side of the graph, which is not at all important or moderately important. It's got a little bit more of an even spread, but it does seem that for most students, the interaction piece is not exactly critical. And I kind of find that as a potentially a missed opportunity. I mean, here you have these experiences with such a diverse group of culture, age range, I mean, you name it. There's such a diverse group of people all in one spot that have motivations for the same kind of content and passion for the same thing. Are we missing opportunities to kind of get more out of that potential experience, the diverse people that are all together? And this is the same one here, too. It's a very similar kind of thing. As I have friends taking this course, trying to see if people are kind of teaming up with their friends to kind of embark upon these activities. Not at all important. So most people are doing this by themselves. At least that's what they reported here. It doesn't seem to be much of a group activity. Here's kind of the opposite of the question we asked earlier. The course relates to my current job responsibilities or company's line of business. So you kind of expect to see this, but they're not at all important because a lot of people already said they're taking this out of general enjoyment and curiosity. And we're going to flip into the post-course survey. Now, this survey, when we put this comparison together, we hadn't finished our energy MOOC yet. So this is just going to have four different course comparisons here. And we asked some things on how many hours they're spending per week in the MOOC. A lot of 0 to 5, a lot of 5 to 10. Once you get to 10 plus, you start to see a pretty significant drop-off here. So that seems to be about the norm, and the bulk in the 0 to 5 here. The art course was more of an even split between 0 to 5 and 5 to 10. So this was an interesting one, and I wasn't sure what to expect out of this. We asked if students agreed or disagreed that they should be awarded some sort of college credit for completing the MOOCs. It's kind of split down the middle, although I would say it's a little bit tilted over to the right. And you can see that the creativity course is heavily tilted to the right. Most of the red bars there, a lot of people in the creativity course thought that maybe they should get some college credits here. So I'm not sure really what to make of this. This is one that I think might deserve some follow-up questions or might need some more mulling over here to really understand, you know, what can we take away from this? I think we're just kind of curious what people's opinions were.
Bart, I'm wondering, though, how much of the instructional design and the instructional rigor plays a role in this as well. In other words, if I took a MOOC, I'm not saying this happened, but if I took a MOOC that did not require, you know, substantive types of responses and assignments and such, maybe I'd kind of say, nah, you know, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Whereas in that creativity MOOC, they were really pushing you. I mean, there was some workload there. Mm-hmm. Maybe students felt like after that, yeah, dang, that was a lot of work. You know, that would be worth a credit or a two-credit course type thing.
Yeah, I think that's something we definitely need to look into. The folks at Duke were asked, have you looked at what percentage of your post-course survey respondents could be matched to pre-course? We have. I don't know the percentage offhand, but I think it's the same. It's less than, I know it's less than 50%. Mm-hmm. I think it's actually less than 40%. One thing we did notice on the pre-course survey is of the people that do the pre-course survey, anywhere from 30 to 40% of those students complete. So it's one of those things that you get a little bit of a biased group, and that makes sense, right? They're engaged. They're interested to be there. They're excited to be there, and they're willing to do a little more, right? They're willing to fill out these surveys and so on. So we do notice that our pre-course survey respondents are much more likely to complete the course than the non-responders. We asked if this course met the personal goals, and this is one of the interesting things with the MAPS course, right? So when we saw this, we thought, you know, this is strange. I wonder why the MAPS course is a little further slanted to the left, to the disagree, than the other courses. And it turns out Anthony had this really interesting scenario where his course was designed for people that were new to geography and making maps. But he had a huge industry following. He had a whole bunch of people from the industry engaged in the course, because apparently it was the first one on kind of map making. So the people that were in the course that were in the industry found it very beginner, you know, very lightweight, very easy, not challenging. So I think a lot of those folks are the ones that answered neutral, disagree, strongly disagree. And the people that were new to maps, probably did find it very useful. But when we first saw this, we were kind of wondering about that, and Anthony was able to say, yeah, I had a lot of veterans that are in the industry in my course, so this might be why some of these are coming out. So we asked, if we didn't meet personal goals, what were some reasons? And again, this might be one of the things we want to rephrase and add some additional things here. The biggest one for a lot of these courses is more practically relevant content. I would wager if we asked some of our resident students this question, the same answer would apply. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that people are just looking for more practical, immediately relevant things that they can apply to what they're doing every day. Course difficulty seemed pretty good. Again, MAPS was kind of over on the left a little bit with too light because there were a lot of veterans to geography in there. Mm-hmm. So most people seem to think that it was just right or too light. We definitely see a trend here that very few people said it was too difficult, too heavy. So this was interesting that might influence some of our next designs. What was the most valuable to your learning? Course content was always very big here, just access to the videos. But projects were also very big. The thing about the epidemics course that's somewhat comical here is some people answered projects, but there weren't any in that course, even though we see a small bar in green there that said projects for the epidemics course. We do find a lot of people in the qualitative feedback also write a lot of very positive things about their project experience. Mm-hmm. Well, they value the project experience. The peer review sees, in our experience, an equal amount of positive and negative feedback. If you have a good peer reviewer on the other end that gives you valuable feedback, you're going to probably rave about that experience. If you have someone on the other end that doesn't take the time to give you meaningful feedback, that's going to be the thing that you're going to have some negative comments about. So peer review is kind of this 50-50 split what we're seeing in some of our qualitative feedback on whether it was a good or a bad experience. And one of the things we continue to struggle with is how do you kind of pull apart some of these things that are easy to do in traditional education when people are paying students on the ground and we're giving them credits versus this thing, you know, this MOOC experience? Completion is really easy, right? We have a variable in the database that tells us whether they're completed or not. Engagement's a little harder, but I think we can start to pull apart habits and behaviors and understand a little bit of whether students are engaged or not. This notion of success, though, is really, really hard to figure out. You know, in a resident course, success is pretty easy. Did you pass? Did you fail? Did you get the grade? Can you move on? Mm-hmm. In a MOOC, though, I mean, I'm sure much people approach these things like I do, that I enroll in a whole bunch. I usually complete none. But if I could log into one and show up one day and watch three videos and find something relevant that I can then apply, you know, on a project I'm working on, that's a huge success for me. Mm-hmm. Now, in the database behind that MOOC, I've showed up once and watched three videos. Mm-hmm. So it's not even going to really show that I'm that engaged in the course, you know, but on a personal level and on a professional level, I do a lot of data analysis. So those are the MOOCs I'm getting into. I'm learning about new tools, learning about new methods, but I'm doing it in very small chunks at a time and moving on. And I find that incredibly successful personally. But for data analysts, it looks like I'm, you know, just one of those dabblers that's kind of coming in and leaving very quick.
So again, I'm guessing that that suggests how the question is framed in the survey may have to be revisited, where you might not say, was the course, you know, do we measure success, or do we go back to the learner and say, mm-hmm. based on what you expected out of this experience or what you needed, would you qualify this as a success?
Yeah.
That would be maybe a, you know, that way you could then answer, yeah. You know, I participated in the pieces I needed.
Yeah.
Yes, they helped me learn. Yeah, I'd say that was a success.
Yeah, and that's one of those things that it's almost, we have a pre-course survey, we have a post-course survey, we need like a mid-course survey
yeah.
that we can ask those people that maybe came in during the first 2 weeks mm-hmm. and left if they got something they needed out of this. Because the post-course mm-hmm. surveys, I can't remember the exact stat, but we're looking at close to 85 or 90% of the people that do the post-course survey mm-hmm. completed the course. Mm-hmm. So I think it's pretty clear that for them, that was, they were engaged, sure. it was successful. It was those people that kind of came in and left, you know, that we struggled to get paid mm-hmm. for. So we're doing a lot around research here as well. We're looking into some various peer assessment research. We're looking at engagement and activity patterns. There's a Coursera reputation system on the forum that we're starting to look into. It doesn't really show itself in the forum interactions very much. You can kind of thumb up, thumb down someone on a forum, but behind the scenes, everyone has a forum score. And what we've discovered looking at scores so far is that the people with the highest scores are very supportive and encouraging. So they're saying things like, you know, no, don't drop out yet, or yes, you know, that's a really interesting piece of art that you shared with us on the forum. Not so much adding what I would call critical kind of learning value, like answering questions and pointing to resources and things like that. On the other hand, we've looked at some people that are on the bottom of the reputation system, so that have a lot of negative votes, that write very articulate, very resource-heavy posts, but do it in a very snarky, not very polite way. So there was one person that wrote about, someone said, you know, I think everyone should be forced to share their name on the forum. A whole bunch of people thumbed up, this is great, I think this would get rid of a lot of the trolling and these sorts of things. And someone else came in a few posts down and wrote a very articulate reason on why you might think twice about this. And the person ended the statement with, anyone that puts their name here is an idiot. Mm-hmm. They just ruined all their credibility and hundreds of thumbs down, right? Mm-hmm. but it was an incredibly well-written, informative, you know, articulate post. Mm-hmm. And we start to see a lot of that, that these people that have low reputation value are actually contributing a lot to the forums. They're contributing some interesting and meaningful things, but they just have a bad attitude. So they're just not being very helpful, supportive, encouragement when they're doing it. Yeah. So there's some weird things with the forum reputation we're looking at. We're doing text analysis on some of the forum things. We're pulling in some of our academic partners here that have natural language processing backgrounds or sentiment analysis backgrounds and so on. And we have one researcher that's actually now doing interviews via Skype with people that completed our courses in developing countries, specifically in epidemics and energy, and trying to understand what sort of value completing one of these courses has in that person's life. So both from value to your community to value to getting jobs and moving up professionally and so on. So they actually had so many people volunteer to be interviewed, they had to turn people away because they didn't have the human capacity, the research capacity to interview everyone and code everything.
You know, just to think about a little bit about that, that one of the things that Coursera does when, again, being at the conference was they highlight these one, I call them one-offs. You know, they found one person who was able to take a series of engineering MOOCs and, put 15 of them together and was able to get a job back in a rural village someplace. I always thought that was kind of dangerous to do, to base too many big decisions about resources on these single one-off stories. And when we have the opportunity, when you have 100 people or, 1,000 people responding, yeah, I'd like to be interviewed, isn't that an opportunity for us to do some surveying in a way to gather something from them? It may not be the interview, but I hate to sort of see people who volunteer to provide input and it's water under the bridge.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm not sure if the researcher has kind of created a plan B to do that sort of work. Yeah, there's a lot of research opportunities here, so it's an interesting space to be just in terms of researchers are often data starved. Mm-hmm. And we are extremely data rich in the MOOC space right now. So it's a great partnership that we can put together.
You're in data soup.
That's one way to put it.
So I'm gonna walk through this relatively quickly because I know we're getting late in the hour here and it's a holiday weekend. So, but I do want to just share with you a little bit about this MOOC institutional impact research. I mentioned a little while ago the institutions who are participating with us. I'll review those in a second. Our intent really was to examine the phenomena and understand how it is impacting higher education and if it fits and doesn't fit. And from our own experiences here at Penn State, MOOCs are a bit of an odd duck, and we struggle to find the location, the best place for MOOCs to fit within the institution. For example, who's responsible for funding MOOCs? Who's responsible for evaluating them, who has access to the data, as Bart mentioned, who has the authority to say you can do a MOOC or not do a MOOC, where does that reside? And those are the kinds of things that we are interested in exploring. These are our partner institutions, and we've got a variety of different incentives going on right now. What we did was to sit down as a team of about 15 and look at the structure of the kinds of questions we had, the kind of domains we wanted to look at. We purposefully stayed away from the student data, the pedagogical data that Bart is speaking of, because that's looking inside the MOOC experience, and we wanted to look at it from the external portion. And so we teamed up into these five teams, and what we said was each team can strategize their own approach, whatever they feel is appropriate. We've created a database where we can collect the tools so that we can kind of see what's working for one group and not working for another. And it's been a little slow. I'll have to say we lost a little momentum this spring only because of a few other things going on that have kept us pretty busy. But we want to revisit it again, and we're always looking for people who might be interested in participating with us. And so if you can send me your name, we'd be happy to include you either on the team. This happened from our last time we did this program, MOOCs by Design, and we're now taking individuals to say, hey, our institution would be happy to participate with you as well. So with that, let me wrap up my portion and see if Bart has any closing responses. We have a few more comments coming in. Do you want to speak to any of those, Bart or Brad?
Yeah, sure. I see Laura's note here, and I think that's a great idea to put in a qualitative piece there just about what the MOOCs have inspired students to do. We haven't done that yet, but that's one of the things I think maybe we should consider doing. One of the interesting things we have had happen, especially out of this course called Creativity, Innovation, and Change, we've had two stories about people that have gone on to successfully create a business, essentially. And I can't remember where those were published. They were published in national news outlets.
Oh, yeah. That's Jack Manson.
Yeah, and what's happened for us is they're incredibly interesting stories, and not so much from a research and data collection standpoint, but for kind of illustrating the value of these experiences up the ladder to our administrators, because the story about these students mentioning kind of the MOOC as being their inspiration, you know, we started out this journey with some of our administrators asking about ROI in terms of dollars. And we don't think that's the only ROI that you should think of, right, when you think about these things. So stories like that give Penn State, you know, a fantastic time in the limelight to say, you know, this experience, this free experience we provide to the world has spawned some of these people to go out and be very successful entrepreneurs and so on.
Sure.
So that's done really positive things for us just from a PR standpoint and the ability to talk about ROI in a different lens.
And as we often say, isn't this the mission of the university, you know, is to conduct research and disseminate it to better people's lives? I mean, that's what we do. And so I think whether you have one or two or 100 of these kind of stories, collecting them and understanding that you are impacting people's lives, I think is what gives us a lot of motivation is pretty exciting stuff.
Yeah, that's a great comment there by the Duke folks, that the long-term thing, and that it's a great idea. It's something that we haven't done yet. You know, we weren't sure for a long time if we were ever going to be able to contact these folks again. And it became something that we had to backtrack to IRB and so on. So now we have the ability to do that from our Research Protections Office. And I'd be really curious to see what you find. So I think that's an awesome idea.
By the way, before we wrap up, Brad, I just want to mention that Bart organized a MOOC research summit that we did in February here at Penn State. And I'm hoping we had a great internal response. It was really offered sort of as an internal resource, but we had an interesting outcome of that was the discovery of how many people were interested in MOOCs, and it was a few more in number than we had anticipated. That was interesting. But also it was a place where we could sort of share and tell stories about our own MOOC experiences. I don't know if you're thinking about broadening that a bit next year and maybe inviting some of our guests today from Duke and others to maybe join us. And it was a very informal opportunity, I think, to dig into some of the data. So I'm hoping you'd consider that.
Yeah, I definitely would like to do that. And one of the things that we really pushed on early is, in addition to our kind of educational technology assessment folks at our institution, how can we build partnerships with faculty around this data and helping understand what's going on here? So I'm actually working with Brad next week on, we have a website that's half done that has an outline of a lot of these projects. We have over 20 projects by faculty across our institution looking at the MOOC data. And these aren't the people that taught it or designed it. These are people that are kind of on the outside looking in that see this as an incredibly rich data set, interesting opportunities to maybe help us make sense of this. And I can't really overemphasize the value that we're getting out of our faculty members, specifically in the College of Education and the College of Information Sciences and Technology. You know, we have one lab that has 18 grad students that churned out a massive amount of results in 2.5 weeks, you know, of the data. And we just simply had to provide data to them.
Wow.
And they were able to do all sorts of interesting looks at it and cut it up in meaningful and interesting ways. And they're getting publications out of it, right? That's their currency.
Wow.
You know, so they're getting some interesting publication opportunities out of this that we also get from the institution, a whole bunch of insights we otherwise would have never gotten or taken much longer to get to on our own. So the ability to partner around this data has been a very, very powerful thing here.
Terrific. Any other questions out there that you might be interested in? We really appreciate the level of engagement you've had with us today, because it keeps us motivated as well. And we are sharing some similar stories and as well as maybe some similar frustrations. But I hope you found this to be helpful today. And if you have questions, we have our contact information up there, Brad.
Yeah, so, and Larry, your comment about the MOOC Summit, Research Summit, I think is a good segue here, because one of the things that always I focus on during workshops or one-offs or whatever it may be is, where do we go from here? Mm-hmm. So it's been a great week, and I appreciate some of the private chats I've been getting in the background thanking for me and this group for what's happened over the past week. But where do we go from here? Mm-hmm. And one of the resources is this community that we've built over the past week. So I would encourage you to go to the MOOCs by Design website, where you registered for this series. There's an email there for contacting us if you have questions, if you're interested in looking at that MIRS group that we're all part of here. If you're interested in just touching base with some of the presenters from this week, the resource is there. The reason that Teaching and Learning with Technology Unit here at Penn State has put together this series, both offerings that we've had, is because we want to reach out, and you know, the rising tide raises all ships. Mm-hmm. And that's really what we're trying to do here. And we would love for additional participation as time goes on. So please feel free to contact us if you have any questions, if you're interested in engaging, or if you just want to start a relationship and start talking. I think that we can all pool our resources and make MOOCs better for the institutions that are holding them, and more importantly, for the students that are engaging in them. Mm-hmm. So, with that, I want to thank Bart, I want to thank Larry, and I want to thank all of our presenters. Yep. Over the past week. A lot of effort has gone into this, and I want to thank the Teaching and Learning with Technology Unit here at Penn State for sponsoring this. And most importantly, I want to thank all of our participants who have joined us over the past week and have been so engaging. You can email us with any questions that you have, and we will also be posting recordings of these sessions over the next few weeks. We have to tackle the closed captioning process for each of those. But once that's done, we'll post them up on our website, and we will send emails out to all registered participants to let them know that those recordings are available. So with that, thank you all. I hope to see you next time we have a series of this type, and I hope that you've gained quite a bit out of this experience, at least as much as I have. Thanks.